So, is Dr. Hashemi?
Yeah.
Come on down. We're loading up your presentation, Brian. Do you want to pull it up for me? So, your topic is cognitive medical environment, and you are an engineer, correct?
I'm an engineer, yes.
Hang on, you need a hat.
Good evening, everyone. My talk is not going to be as exciting as the previous one. My talk is not going to be as exciting as the previous one because I'm an engineer, which means that you are going to see a bunch of boring technical stuff, and hopefully you can relate it to the application. But what I'm really here to present is the collaborative vision. And I'm just representing a group of people. All five of us are in the department of Mingxi Department of Electrical Engineering at the Viterbi School of Engineering at USC.
Yeah. Okay.
And I promised that I will bring some gadgets to actually show you we do things, and they do work. But I got way too busy. In fact, I just came from a group meeting. I had my students waiting for me, and I'm returning to it. So if you give me the prize, if somebody can just accept it from my hand. That doesn't mean that you should not give me the prize. But the idea here is that there is, in the Department of Electrical Engineering at USC, there is a lot of work that is done both at the hardware and software level. And these are involving nanosciences, some physical sciences, circuits and hardware, integration, and communication networks, data fusion, and cognitive human interface. And so what we envision is that in the future, which could be as near as several years ago, you are going to carry devices with you such as this, which are not just going to be your iPhone anymore. There is going to be much more sensing capability inside of them embedded, and many of them for your for monitoring your physical activities. What I didn't bring right now with me, and I think you've seen it a couple of days ago, is a device which is smaller than this, probably half the size, but if you put it in your pocket, monitors your biometric activities, such as your breathing and your heartbeat, without any contact, and pretty reliably gives you information such as score volume if you're interested in it, or other kind of things. And this is the version we have right now. If you come to the lab, you are going to see versions where we do things even remotely, so I can remotely actually monitor all your activities right now from here. And then this also serves as a communication hub, so not only it serves as a sensor for you, but also it communicates with the network, which means that now you, as most of you probably are physicians here, are going to have access to the medical information, and just because I carry one of them with me. So what you see here is probably a piece of jewelry that maybe you put in your hand if you're a lady, and if you're a man, probably we come with something for you that has all these sensing capability for you. And this is just an example. So basically you can have a wearable device that integrates multiple sensors. The kind of things that we envision, which are doable at this point, we have in the lab working. We can measure your heartbeat and stroke volume, 3D pattern pretty accurately wirelessly using the device. We can measure your 3D motion, your acceleration, your temperature, your location. Some of these are basically integrating existing sensors into a unique platform, and some of them, the sensing part, is where the science is, where the engineering is. For instance, the biometric measurement is something that we just don't have it in the world, but we can do it. One of the most exciting parts of our work is that we take the nano devices that are developed in the lab as they are right now for measuring things such as air quality. So if you're interested in knowing how much pollution is out there, I don't know how many of you are from LA, but we care about it here. So you can just carry a device that monitors it for you automatically using these nano devices. And they automatically wirelessly interconnect with a network backbone. Some of them using existing protocols. These are the current generation Bluetooth, you may have heard of it. But but a lot of our communication faculty here are working in designing robust networking protocols that are beyond that. So these are selected research challenges that we face, a few of us. I only focus on one, my part, not that it's the most important one, just because I understand it better, which is the second part. And this is measuring the human biometric information, specifically heartbeat and stroke volume and breathing activity wirelessly. And the way we do that is send very short electromagnetic waves to the body, and the libido numbers so good that I can detect the minute movements of your heart. So that's reflection, that reflects it back to me. And I can design very, very sensitive, essentially, radars that can detect that and give me all that information. And I can do actually even better than that. I can do it for many of you wirelessly. So if I succeed in what I think I can succeed, and we have things in the lab, I can isolate your heartbeats before I stand right now, so I can see with my closed eyes who's doing what here. And hopefully that has some medical prospects to it. I didn't talk about the rest, but the real vision is this one. So we think that very soon you're going to enter a room where all these sensing activities, all these sensing functions are a part of the environment. You may not even need to carry them with you. So in the room as you enter, you turn on the light, most likely there's going to be a sensor that knows that you entered it, and it notes your health functions because it's wirelessly monitoring it. And if, God forbid, you're not fit enough, if your heartbeat is faster or slower, or if you're sweating more than what you should be sweating, and maybe it connects automatically to your doctor and tells them about it. So we envision an environment where you have continuous real-time patient monitoring, and you can have it in hospitals, medical offices, or you can have it in your home. And this is going to involve a lot of hardware, so multiple sensing modalities, and a lot of data fusion and communication devices. And we don't have it right now, but I don't think this is science fiction. I think it actually can happen, probably in the next 10 years or so. That's all I have to say.
Thank you very much. Now, do you have time to listen to what people think about your... Okay, good. Because it was really interesting and very germane to tomorrow. John?
The first person that turned me on to this idea was Gene Roddenberry for the ability to collect information. I think the challenge here is not collecting data. This is, I think, a contemporary way of collecting a lot of information. I think the challenge is, what do you do with the information? How can you create an actionable type of event? And as much as it sounds interesting to have continuous real-time monitoring, I think there's a lot of people that don't want to see all of this information real-time and on the receiving end. So the challenge is, it's not just the collection, it's what do you do with it, and how can you make it digestible so that the healthcare provider pays attention to the important things and can let the unimportant things go by.
Thank you. John?
Absolutely. Two commercial concepts. Online security.
I bought my ex-wife that Bulgari ring. It cost me like 12 grand. And in the divorce settlement I had to give it to her as a gift. I got nothing back in return.
Right.
But looking at problems in medicine, okay, this is I call it the bottom-up approach, which is I've got all these technologies, let me do something with them, as opposed to be commercially successful, what you have to say is, here's a problem in medicine, here's a gap, here's something that's missing, I can apply these technologies to them. I think my advice would be, find a problem you can focus on, and take your technology and apply it to it.
Great. It's like one of my colleagues says, Neil. He says this with a lot of passion. He says, divorce is expensive, but it's worth it.
Absolutely. I do it all
over
again. I think from a innovative perspective, it's not really that new, frankly. It's already been discussed and talked about. And I think it's too general from a commercialization perspective. And you know, if you think of going to market from things that make sense the most, you know, there are a lot of legal and medical problems that have to be resolved first. So maybe my advice would be pick a particular application as a starting point using this technology that may not be so contentious, and let the effect snowball. There's a lot of to be said, that as John said, that some things people don't want to know. So how do you balance that? Maybe something more benign like weight management or diabetes control as a launch pad for some of the more advanced applications.
So maybe sort of following on with what that other panelists have suggested, maybe one area that would be worth taking a hard look at would be military theater, you know, military applications, because the need for protection and monitoring for, you know, chemical and biological warfare attacks would make this very useful.